Friday, you bastard. All right.
On the first day of Hanukkah, my parents gave to me a picture of my bed at Bernice. On the second day of Hanukkah, my parents gave to me two stinking dreidels and a picture of my bed at Bernice. The third day of Hanukkah, my parents gave to me three ugly shirts, two stinking dreidels, and a picture of my bed in Bernice.
So what?
Well, you look at it.
What's that weird thing on her head?
That's her face.
Oy.
On the fourth day of Hanukkah.
Hanukkah.
That's cool. My parents gave to me lousy kosher candy, three ugly shirts, two stinking dreidels.
Sing the dreidel song.
No.
Sing it.
Dreidel, 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 I made it out of clay. And when no one is watching, I'll throw the thing away.
No, was that nice?
Fight me.
Oy.
On the fifth day of Hanukkah, my parents yelled at me
for wanting a Christmas tree.
What?
Well, Jimmy's got one.
Maybe Jimmy's Catholic.
Oh.
And not wanting candy.
Not wanting shirts.
Not wanting dreidels.
Or a picture of my bed in Bernice.
Amen.
On the sixth day of Hanukkah, my parents made me sing,
if I were a rich man.
Oh, God. This song
every year.
In front of my bed in Bernice.
Oh, I think.
On the seventh day of Hanukkah. Not bad. My parents made me eat seven greasy latkes.
If I were a rich man,
I want a Christmas tree. I want a Christmas tree.
I want this noise.
Christmas tree.
Oy, is this a putz?
On the eighth day of Hanukkah, my parents gave to me nothing that I wanted, seven greasy latkes.
If I were a rich man,
where is my Christmas tree?
Shut up!
Lousy kosher candy, three ugly shirts, two stinking dreidels, and a picture of my bed at Bernice.
Oh,
hey, speaking of religious intolerance, one I love every year at this time is always that element of people, of Goyim, who say, oh, well, don't you have a Christmas tree in your house?
Right.
No, we're Jewish. Or no, we're an atheist. Or no, we're whatever the hell we are.
You can
Muslim.
Say, don't you have Buddhist. A Santeria statue in your house?
Yeah, right. Aren't you choking a chicken on your front door today at noon?
Well, back door.
So George is going to read us the results of yesterday's poll.
you son of a bitch.
He would like to do that, but he can't do it. By the way, everybody who calls today, be sure and wish George a happy birthday, because tomorrow is George's birthday. He turns 85.
Yeah, might as well.
So everybody, and of course, George, because of the fact tomorrow's his birthday, has got two appearances instead of one.
That's right. It's the birthday
Which,
tour.
That should kill some good time today, reading that charity drive. My God, that thing's like a book. Abandoned Pet Rescue, and yes, that is our charity, and we're very proud of it for that asshole that called again this year, twice yesterday, no less. $43,840, so today we'll for sure go over 44 grand, and we'll get over 50. Today's only December number 5. Here's the results of yesterday's poll, although I think before we do that, let's give the story of the day. Got a lot more Michael Jackson crap. We got Rush Limbaugh crap. We got Lawrence Phillips crap. How do you like that? Haven't heard his name in a long time. In a coon's age. Woman gets 10 years for running over McDonald's manager.
All right.
A McDonald's customer in Houston who flew into a violent rage when she was denied mayonnaise on her cheeseburger got 10 years in prison today for running over the restaurant's manager. She was denied mayonnaise on her cheeseburger. Didn't anybody tell her that that's trafe?
Right. It's got eggs.
Right. The cheeseburger's kosher, but not with that mayo. Wynetta Nolan, 37, could have received as much as 20 years in prison for hitting Sherry Allen Jenkins with her car dragging the employee across the parking lot and breaking her pelvis at the McDonald's in Southwest Houston. Nolan showed little emotion yesterday afternoon when the jury came back with a punishment after 4 hours of deliberation. Earlier yesterday, however, as the jury heard testimony in the punishment phase of Nolan's trial, her 43-year-old victim tearfully said she couldn't pick up her grandchildren because of the injury she suffered in the incident. I put the mayonnaise on her burger, Jenkins told the jury. I took the onions and the mustard off. What did I do? Jurors took less than an hour to convict Nolan of aggravated assault in the courtroom of State District Judge Brock Thomas. Nolan testified she thought she had rolled over a bump when she ran over Jenkins. Right. The incident began when an 18-year-old employee working at the drive-thru window near Bissonnet and Beltway told Nolan mayonnaise was not an option on McDonald's cheeseburgers. When Nolan became angry, she was encouraged to pull her car around the window to the window counter and speak to the manager. Witnesses said Nolan cursed and threw a cheeseburger back through the drive-thru window. When Jenkins offered a special order cheeseburger with mayonnaise, witnesses said Nolan complained her French fries had grown cold. After receiving new fries, she then demanded a new drink. Unable to pacify the belligerent customer, Jenkins finally called the police, who asked her to get the customer's license plate number. Jenkins walked out to the drive-thru line to get the number. Nolan testified she had inched her car forward to put ketchup on her burger when she heard a car horn. Realizing she was blocking drive-thru traffic, she said she gunned her car forward to hit Jenkins. She floored it. After running over Jenkins, witnesses said Nolan sped from the parking lot and drove into oncoming traffic on a one-way feeder road. She was arrested at her home after a man who saw the assault followed her and reported her plate to the police. How do you like that? Over Mayo.
Only 10 years?
What a crazy-ass bitch. Mm-hmm. What a miserable, nasty slut. And speaking of crazy-ass people, well, let me give the poll results. On a personal level, how do you feel about George W. Bush, we asked yesterday? 1,419 vote. And you couldn't crack 12%, by the way. They tried very hard, the Bushlickers. They got him, goosed him up there a couple of times to an even 12%, but the final total, he ain't going to cut it. Of the positive votes, 11.8. On a personal level, how do you feel about George W. Bush? He's a bumbling idiot, wins, 454. I hate him like poison, 360. He's a compulsive, devious liar, 248. He means well, but he's over his head, 100, by the way. They tried very hard, the Bushlickers. They got him, goosed him up there a couple of times to an even 12%, but the final total, he ain't going to cut it. Of the positive votes, 11.8. On a personal level, how do you feel about George W. Bush? He's a bumbling idiot, wins, 454. I hate him like poison, 360. He's a compulsive, devious liar, 248. He marijuana people, they just, rot in jail forever, especially in New York State.
Mandatory.
Right. But scumbags who keep molesting and raping and abusing and this, all of these things, they slap them on the wrist, they keep putting them back out on the street again. Like Lawrence Phillips and like that Rodriguez scumbag.
Right. Paco.
Phillips, who started at the University of Nebraska, and was also charged with assault and uttering threats. Police say the incident involving his girlfriend took place in Montreal November 27th. Phillips, 28, was remanded in custody until today after he failed to post $1,000 bail. He was released by Calgary October 10th for disrupting practice by arguing with Coach Jim Baker over the team's offensive strategy. He was released in May by the Montreal Alouettes for failing to meet what the team said were minimum behavioral standards. Phillips insisted it was because he had demanded a major pay raise. Due to a police record in the U.S., Phillips needed a government permit renewal each year to play in Canada. While at Nebraska, Phillips pleaded no contest to domestic violence and a confrontation with a girlfriend. To put it mildly, a confrontation. This is in the Hero. Confrontation? That was when he stuffed her in a goddamn locker. Remember that?
Yes, I do.
Beat her up and stuffed her in the locker. But it was a confrontation, is all it was. We got some Michael Jackson stuff. It's kind of disturbing. Now, of course, the show of the New York Times, even the prestigious New York Times, is often full of crap, like they were yesterday. About how the case against Jackson was like perhaps crumbling. The case was, right. Case is looking pretty damn bad, if you ask me. Former sheriff, second child claimed in 1993 Jackson molested him, and we got the Inquirer story, which I notice all the newspapers, including the South Florida papers, are picking up on now. The only difference being the Inquirer picked this up days ago, and it was in the issue I picked up yesterday on the newsstand, which now it appears in all the newspapers. Secret witness, I saw Michael do it. You're going to read that? Yes.
He dude it.
And then, of course, we got the Rush Limbaugh crap, man. Man, has he got some crap. And, of course, you do realize it's just a witch hunt. You don't
That's
understand
a
that.
Fishing expedition.
Just a fishing expedition. Everybody whip out your pole. Stick a worm on the end of it. Because we're going fishing. Yeah. He was going shopping, not fishing. Shopping for doctors,
right.
So they say.
He has a legitimate need.
He had a legitimate pill-popping need. So that's what's on the agenda. Let's see, the first poll today. Let's do the first one. We got two polls again. Plus, we got no spots today. We're having a going-out-of-business sale. What? Well, it's the holidays. Why would anybody anybody want to advertise during the December holidays when everybody does about 70% of their business for the whole year? He was going shopping, not fishing. Shopping for doctors,
right.
So they say.
He has a legitimate need.
He had a legitimate pill-popping need. So that's what's on the agenda. Let's see, the first poll today.
Come on, baby. Come play with these titties.
Okay.
Oh, so bright. It's almost blinding like furry satellites. Them reindeer in the night.
I never thought about that. I guess Santa can't come down your chimney if you live in a condo, right?
Right.
But if you're in South Florida and you live in a condo, you're probably Jewish anyway, so who the hell wants to see Santa Claus? 17 votes, that's all we got so far.
Them reindeer in the night. Ho, 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 ho. Do, do, do,
dee, da, 10-19, never thought about that. I guess Santa can't come down your chimney if you live in a condo, right?
Right.
But if you're in South Florida and you live in a condo, you're probably Jewish anyway, so who the hell wants to see Santa Claus? 17 any good. Wait a minute. Oh, and now it just came back.
And now line one is ringing.
This is a pile of Schmidt, man. This is garbage. One moment, please.
Jesus Christ.
Oh, and you want to know why this happens? Because every time there's a problem, I forgot about that. Every time there's a problem with the internet down there, it messes up the phone thing up here.
Yes.
Let's see if line one is working. QAM.
Good morning. How are you, kind sir?
Our phone is working. How do you like that? Thank the Lord for that. Can you imagine?
It's a miracle. It's time of year for miracles.
I got news for you, man. When anything works at QAM, it is a miracle. You're right.
Listen, in reference to your list, believe me, I am as happy as any that Miriam Oliphant is out of office, but you know how the media kind of sweeps stuff under the rug. The woman she replaced was named Jane Carroll.
Right.
A lifelong Republican. She was in that office for 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
She's the one who presided over that mess in 2000. And the day after the election, she got in her car and drove to North Carolina. There was no transition period. Miriam Oliphant started out in a ditch as it was. So Miriam deserves a lot of blame for being an idiot, believe me.
Yes.
But Jane Carroll, who everything that came from the Supervisor of Elections office had Jane Carroll in huge letters, a little tiny letter, Supervisor of Elections. She was a self
work. And there's no dots. I see them flashing, but there's no dots.
Apparently,
oh, no.
The internet, the connection is coming on just for like 2 seconds at a time. Just
spastic.
Just enough to freak you out.
Just enough to give me luck to tease. Well,
right.
You can punch up line two and see if I can hear it. Hello? QAM.
Yeah, who's this?
Who are you calling?
Neil.
This is Neil.
Neil, this is Sal. I tried to get you yesterday. Go Panthers, 6,000 people, 6,000 people. Go Panthers.
Well, click that thing, Sal. Click it. What? He's clicking it. Those are the clickers they give out, baby. 6,000 people. There was like maybe 3,000 for that game the other night, for that make-believe game against Ottawa. I mean, that was pathetic. That was Sal.
Yeah,
chronic.
Yeah. Hey, look what I can do.
You know how long that guy's been calling talk shows? My God, he's been around since before Heinrich Himmler was an infant. Man. So all the lines are smoking here, but I can't. Oh, wait a minute. I see some dots. Here's line 9, the chronic line. Hello.
Hey, Neil. How you doing?
Pretty good.
Sweet. I'm calling from Orlando, man. I call up the local radio station here, Rosilio.
Right.
They don't know anything about Pharrell coming up here.
What do you mean Pharrell coming up there? Who said Pharrell's...
I heard yesterday Pharrell's supposed to be up in Orlando, Rosilio.
Yeah, right.
Oh, man, that was a lie.
Who told you that crap?
No! All right, I guess I'm...
No, Cilio is going to be on in Miami on WRFX starting January 5.
Oh, okay. I'm
with
a
his
dumbass,
with
I
his .00 share.
Oh, okay. No, I thought he was going to be up in Orlando.
No, not that we know of, Pally.
Okay, I'm sorry. I take it back. Ken Mulder.
Have a great weekend, man.
Ken Mulder.
Ah, bring it, bring it.
Wow. So even Jim Sarney finally caught on. Did you get your stuff back? Because my dots are back and the lines are flashing frantically. This is good. This indicates we got somebody. Just relax, okay? You know it's an effed up place.
Yeah,
it's just the way it is.
Here's the facts. The internet
that
is
says...
down.
We apologize for the ineptitude of our engineering staff. I take back all the good things I said about Fix It. He's an idiot. Changes in the morning at WRFX, writes Jim Sarney. Carl, well, how, this last guy that called from Orlando, he couldn't hear it either, right? He was just all breathless to call and get the straight poop, get the lowdown, get the dope on Pharrell. But Pharrell didn't go to Orlando that we know of. At any rate, Carl Foster's morning bullpen is gone.
All right.
Dan Cilio's show is coming. That's what Jim Sarney writes. The morning, of course, we told you this yesterday. The morning bullpen ended its run on WRFX last week when Foster's contract with Clear Channel expired. Foster said he'll announce new plans for the morning bullpen and other shows this week. Right. Cilio, the former U of M player who hosts a talk show on WQTM, the lowly last place rated 7:40 a.m. in Orlando, will add WRFX to the mix on January 5th, 6 to 9 a.m. Cilio's silly show will continue to be based in Orlando, but he says it'll have appeal to South Florida fans who really want to hear about the Magic and the Tampa Bay Bucks and all of those things. And the Jaguars. All of these things. What crap. We got some heavy-duty crap coming up. Former sheriff says second child claimed in 1993 that Michael molested him. And then we got the big stuff here, secret witness, eyewitness, I saw Michael do it, from the Inquirer, which I'm going to read in its entirety. We got the Rush Limbaugh doctor shopping story.
Hey, no.
People of Florida say, as far as paying any taxes for a stadium for the Marlins, the people say
no.
80 to 15%. Not too close. And speaking of polls, good news. Bush is supporting Florida, dropping like a rock.
Oh!
Excellent news.
Oh!
And even more excellent news,
oh!
Just relax, is that Howard Dean has moved into lead among Democratic contenders. 6 months ago, he had 1% in Florida. In the latest poll, he's got 16%, leading very nearly Wes Clark, 15, and Jew Lieberman,
boy,
who was leading before, has got 15. I think a few of them old Jews that supported Lieberman probably died in the interim. Now, we got a heavy plate as far as stuff going on this weekend. Let's see. From 11 to 1 today, Joe and Mark will be at the Singular Wireless at 11925 West Sunrise Boulevard. They're kicking off their second annual Joe and Mark Toy Drive to benefit the Joe DiMaggio Children's Hospital. And also, they'll have the best in new merchandise as well.
Yeah.
So they'll be 11 to 1 at the Singular Wireless, 11925 West Sunrise Boulevard. And then later today, 4 to 6, the van will be at Hollywood Chrysler Jeep, located at 2100 North State Road 7, just north of Sheridan Street. And tomorrow, on George's birthday, you can go by and wish George a happy birthday and get our best Neil stuff.
Right.
Tomorrow, noon to 2, George will be at Fort Lauderdale Imports, or Lauderdale Imports, whatever it's called, Lauderdale Imports / BMW, at 1400 South Federal Highway and 4-1 at the Singular Wireless, 11925 West Sunrise Boulevard. And then later today, 4 to 6, the van will be at Hollywood Chrysler Jeep, located at 2100 North State Road 7, just north of Sheridan Street. And tomorrow, on George's birthday, you can go by and wish George a happy birthday and get our best Neil stuff.
Right.
Tomorrow, noon to 2, George will be at Fort Lauderdale Imports, or Lauderdale Imports, whatever it's
Friday, you bastard.
It's Jorge's birthday. It's Jorge's birthday. And we would like to see the Julio get laid.
Yes.
It's Jorge's birthday. It's Jorge's birthday. We hope this time he puts a rubber on Oy Vey. It's Jorge's birthday. It's Jorge's birthday. And we would like to see the Julio.
Incredible. 10:31. Happy birthday to George. And by the way, I got some special news for you. Dwight Lauderdale passed along a message when I was down there, but I've saved it for the day before your birthday.
Yeah.
Wanted to thank you profusely for turning him on to eating ass.
Oh, yeah, no sweatski. That's
he
why
said
he shaved
it's the
that
most
mustache.
Silly. He did have to shave off his mustache
right.
in order to, like, avoid leaving
That's
any
right.
telltale evidence behind. He wanted to leave no hairs on Ann's ass.
Oh, no.
But he said he's having the time of his life over there at Channel 10, just eating every ass that comes by his puss. I was thinking about that yesterday, about that whole episode.
Yes.
Do we still have that tape?
I have it on a file.
Oh, man, that is so... If we could ever put that on our website, all the people at Channel 10 might get embarrassed, but that's okay. It was. It should be public domain by now, shouldn't it?
Sure.
Yeah.
They're talking about you.
They're talking about eating ass, eating ass. That was a whole Matty Bell thing, and they played the wrong tape, and Dwight Lauderdale sitting there about as schmitz-based as you can get.
Oh, that Neil sure is funny.
Yeah, right. 77 votes on the poll. In fact, if they would have kept talking about eating ass, Channel 10 probably have an 80 share down there, but they don't. They didn't wise up. And Don, do you think that Don approved of that? I know Todd Tungen liked it. Whose credibility took the biggest hit in the past 5 years? We got 77 votes. We apologize again to the people who can't hear me talking right now. The phone is a spastic, you should know.
Yeah.
And that is, I have dots right now, and I see lines flashing, but then I notice lines keep flashing, but every now and then the dots go out, which means there's no point in punching them up at that point. See what I'm saying?
Extra fun
it's
today.
Mess. It's a technical mess. It's what we specialize in at WQAM, a technical disaster. And Duff is sitting in there with his head deep inside Clarence's ass, checking everything out for the weekend, and nothing's going on. Are there engineers in there frantically doing stuff now or not?
I saw somebody. I don't know.
Right. 82 votes. 36 say Rush Limbaugh's credibility took the biggest hit in the past 5 years. Pop a couple of more, Rush. He's out shopping for doctors right now.
Hey, he had legitimate need.
Yeah.
Not like those medical marijuana
people.
It's a people.
Fishing expedition. Tony Blair, 14. Colin Powell, 12. Look who's on it. Oh, just a second he was on there, Colin Powell.
Right.
Jesse Jackson, 8. With that love child. Now, when the hell did that love child thing happen?
Like 2 years ago?
There you go. Miriam Elephant, 6. Michael Jackson, 4. And I guess assuming that he never had any credibility anyway, because the first episodes, plural, took place in 93, which is 10 years ago. And Pat Riley's got a pair out of 82 votes. Pat Riley's got a small pair, but he does have nice slick back hair and does listen to the show. How you doing, Pat? A
Ooh,
man of
that.
Pleasure right
look
now.
Look at that on CNN right now.
What's that? Catholic sex scandal forced the sale of mansion. That's the story we had yesterday.
Dollar mm-hmm. bill. To settle abuse claims. The building and land have been valued from $14 to $100 million.
All right. $85 million, they said they're going to hope to raise from the sale of that building. They got to raise money to pay for their pedophiles, speaking of Michael Jackson. I'll tell you one thing. I wish that the media was as outraged. They were for like a few weeks there, and then, of course, we had the Vatican and a dog and pony show in Houston, and they had the meeting with Dallas, wherever the hell it was. And, you know, oh, well, this is outrageous, and we're not going to tolerate this. And in the meantime, it's still going on. You can bet your life on that. You can bet $1 million, even if you don't have it on that, that it's still going on every single day. Former sheriff's second child claimed in 1993 that Jackson molested him.
Oy!
Former Santa Barbara Sheriff Jim Thomas said there was a second child who claimed in 1993 that Michael Jackson molested him. Those accusations were audio taped, but not videotaped, the sheriff be saying. Sources close to the prosecution in the current alleged molestation case against the pop star say that the second alleged 1993 victim could be called to testify, unlike 1993 when he was much younger and frightened. He was a scared. District Attorney Tom Steddon said Thursday he still plans to file charges in mid-December against Jackson for the singer's alleged molestation of another boy more recently. He also scoffed at published reports that speculate the case is weak because charges have not yet been filed. Everything will become clear when the charges are filed, Sneddon be saying. Yeah, New York Times really blew that yesterday. We apologize to New York Times. They're under a lot of stress. Their credibility is waning. Jackson, 45. Well, we know that. Jackson, the defense attorney, Mark Garagos, did not return several phone calls seeking comment about the second alleged victim in 93, but a source close to the defense told CNN he believes the defense is aware of such claims. In other words, now, all of a sudden, they quit opening up a big mouth, you know? Well, we're going to come down like an elephant squashing an ant on you if you... Yeah. Now that more stuff is coming out, including that story from the Inquirer, which I'm going to read in its entirety momentarily, I guess we'll do much reading today because the phone is like touch and go, you know?
Yeah.
But we'll get some calls in there because the show ain't crap without all those great calls.
That's right.
Charges were never filed in 1993 after the first alleged victim dropped out of any criminal proceedings when his family settled with Jackson reportedly for millions of dollars, 15.3, so they say, those who know best. Thomas, who conducted the decade-old investigation into molestation charges in cooperation with L.A. police, told CNN yesterday the second accuser in 1993, a boy aged 9 or 10 at the time, decided he was too ashamed to testify against Jackson and didn't want his friends to know. The parents also did not want the boy or themselves subjected to a take-no-prisoners defense, Thomas said. The child didn't want to testify, and we can't force a child to testify, so we never went forward, he'd be saying. A source close to the current prosecution confirmed to CNN there was a second alleged victim in 1993. Thomas said he believed the second child would have gone forward with the allegations had other alleged victims come forward. He said the case was strong, but it would have been up to a jury to decide, and it never got that far. The allegations by the second child did not go to the same level of molestation as that detailed in a graphic declaration by the first alleged victim in 93, sources familiar with the audio tape statement said, but the same sources described the second claim as credible and said the pattern was similar to how Jackson courted and seduced his special friends, as investigators referred to the boys. The former sheriff said a parent of the second boy intervened upon learning of his alleged molestation and severed contact with Jackson. The parent was angry, pissed, foaming at the mouth, said Thomas. The former sheriff sent investigators all over the country and as far as the Philippines to investigate other reports of sexual molestation by the gloved one. How do you like that, huh? I hope they fry his freaking stupid ass.
Yeah.
So sick and tired not only of him, but those assholes who defend him. Did you see that thing out there this morning?
I sure did.
One of those black charities that he gives money to. See, everybody wants their hand in the trough. That's why LaToya changed her tune all of a sudden. The same LaToya that 10 years ago was just ripping him an ass.
That damn faggot, I can't stand him.
Yeah, say it again, LaToya.
That damn faggot, I can't stand him.
You go, girl. I'm so sick and tired of these nauseating assholes. A bunch of schwarzes out there demonstrating, Michael, Michael. Yeah, because they want to continue living off the trough.
Sure.
With all his charitable donations. Right. Just make me, and the same with LaToya and the rest of the family. You know, what's his name, Jebediah?
Right. Jeremiah.
Yeah, but is it germane to the case what he has to say? That's the question. And I think the answer is
no.
No. He don't want to stop that gravy train, okay? He's just like a hungry dog, man. He wants that gravy train to keep on coming. Speaking of dogs, Florida investigators have raided Rush Limbaugh's doctor's offices and seized his medical records. In the first sign, the radio jock could face criminal charges for buying black market drugs. I love the way they refer to him as the radio jock, you know?
Yeah.
Nobody's a talk show host or a jock, a disc jockey, something like that.
Jock.
Or maybe he just wears a jock, probably a real big one. The blockbuster development was revealed yesterday in search warrants that accused Limbaugh of doctor shopping to find a steady supply of under-the-counter painkillers. Under-the-counter.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Limbaugh's actions violate the letter and spirit of the law, one of the warrants said on file at the Palm Beach County Courthouse. Limbaugh lined up four doctors to provide him with controlled substances in alternated positions to obtain overlapping prescriptions, according to warrants that were issued November 25 before cops raided the orifices in West Palm Beach and Jupiter. The right-wing radio jock has not been charged with a crime yet. In an apparent bid to blunt the impact of the revelations, Limbaugh said on his syndicated show yesterday that prosecutors were on a fishing expedition. Let us make our position clear. Rush Limbaugh is not part of a drug ring, Limbaugh said, reading from a script prepared by defense attorney Roy Black. We won't speculate on why the state attorney's office is handling Mr. Limbaugh's case the way it is. The Palm Beach County state's attorney, whose painkiller probe ensnared Limbaugh, issued a statement saying that only that all medical records have been obtained by court-sanctioned search warrants. New York criminal defense attorney Louis I. Dallas said it appears investigators are building a case specifically against Limbaugh that could be brought before a grand jury.
All right.
There will be a decision made whether to prosecute, Idella said. I guess that Mr. Limbaugh is having a few sleepless nights these days. Limbaugh, who recently fessed up to being a painkiller junkie, denied doing anything criminal yesterday, said he was being singled out because of his prominence and well-known political opinions and being a big fat hypocrite. Oh,
yep.
Limbaugh, who lives in a $24 million Palm Beach palace, went into rehab 5 weeks in October after the probe was revealed. He admitted being hooked on prescription painkillers, including OxyContin and hydrocodone, which he took for back pain, and which also caused his hearing to just about disappear and everybody to have all that sympathy for poor Rush.
You know, I know what's good for sleepless nights.
I can't even stand the smell of that damn Rush.
Live and local, we're Sports Radio 560 QAM.
God.
Picked a bad day to quit sniffing goo. He drew the rush drug Limbaugh, bouncing off the walls in a rehab room. He drew the rush drug Limbaugh, Limbaugh.
He drew the rush drug Limbaugh.
He drew the rush drug Limbaugh, Limbaugh.
He drew the rush drug Limbaugh.
He drew the rush drug Limbaugh. Unknown from God and hateful and rotten. He do the rush drug Limbaugh, snorting and popping illegal oxycontin. He do the rush drug Limbaugh, Limbaugh.
He do the rush drug Limbaugh.
He do the rush drug Limbaugh, Limbaugh.
Limbaugh. Little girl and candy, I had an epiphany, my friends. An epiphany pissed on me. Under the rug is where the story's going. He do the rush, drug, Limbaugh. Damage control so they can pigeonhole it. He do the rush, drug, Limbaugh. Limbaugh. He do the rush, drug, Limbaugh. Limbaugh. He do the rush, drug, Limbaugh.
With talent, of course, on loan from his neighborhood, Eckerd's. Gold Rush, this is in this week's Inquirer, the December 16 issue. I told you that we always get, for whatever reason here, the tabloids, luckily, several days ahead. I don't know why.
No, we don't get them at all here anymore.
You don't get the internet, you don't get the tabloids, you don't get your bonus until they damn well feel like...
Right.
You don't get much of anything. Don't get laid, that's for sure.
Soros, get that one.
Authorities probe his drug debt for a housekeeper. The Inquirer exclusive revealing Rush Limbaugh's secret addiction to black market painkillers disclosed that the super-rich radio host went deeply in debt to his drug-supplying ex-housekeeper. Several days ahead, I don't know why.
No, we don't get them at all here anymore.
You don't get the internet, you don't get the tabloids, you don't get your bonus until they damn well feel like...
Right.
You don't get much of anything. Don't get laid, that's for sure.
Soros, get that.
Authorities probe his drug debt for a housekeeper. The Inquirer exclusive revealing Rush Limbaugh's secret addiction to black market painkillers disclosed...
Why don't you go back to Cuba, you spick bastard?
The 80s are back!
They are?
Uh-huh. And 50s funny man Jerry Lewis is, too.
Are you sure?
Well, kind of. And now the 50s meet the 80s to form a super group for the new millennium. Introducing Jerry Lewis and the News.
Hey, lady! The heart of rock and roll, is still beating with the ventricles and the aorta in Cleveland already with Sheboygan and the Flagel and all those places.
The king of comedy is about to become the prince of pop. It's Jerry Lewis and the News.
Hey, lady, oh, please, I'd like a new drug. No needles, please. Just a nice man, pharmacist-type person in the white coat, please. I sign here, thank you.
Hey, it's hip to be square. And it's even hipper to buy something round, like the new CD from Jerry Lewis and the News.
Available. You can find it wherever fine records are sold with the nice man behind the counter to help you find it with the nice lady person, okay? Boy.
So here are the pictures in the Inquirer. Moonface comic Jerry Lewis sheds 51 pounds in rehab. He looks not too bad.
Yeah?
Not that I'm all that pleased about it or that concerned because we wish it would just go away. But it's got this side by each picture is the one with a humongous fat face that looked like a buffo toad, like somebody stuck a tube up in his esophagus and just pumped up his head. And then the other one next to that where he looks a lot more like him. Aren't you excited?
Oh, thrilled.
He's weaning himself off prednisone, the drug that made him balloon to 250 pounds. He hopes to look like himself again in time for the March 4th show in Las Vegas. He's lost 51 pounds while in rehab, and a pal says the 77-year-old star is feeling great. He'll soon be back at work. He's definitely going to beat his addiction to prednisone. He's got a fantastic attitude, even though we find him obnoxious, disgusting, and a real pain in the ass and old and tired. He's got a lot of energy. He's going to make good his vow to be out of rehab and perform March 4th at the Orleans Hotel and Casino. I bet you you'll be there for that.
Oh, yeah. Bell's on.
Okay. Well, now that we got the dots back and we got the phone now, you got everything? Is the internet back or what?
No.
Oh. Well, I better grab these real quick, like, because I bet they'll be real good. WQAM. Hello? See, I know it's working,
mm-hmm.
but they're just playing with me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's only two lines that were flashing. Have you got, how many lines you got? I only got one now.
Three.
You have three?
Yes.
Well, but not, just as I said that and looked up now, there are three.
Four.
WQAM.
Yeah, I can't believe George doesn't know about Pat Tornillo.
Isn't that pathetic?
Who?
Pat Tornillo.
Right.
The United Teachers of Dade.
Right.
President.
Criminal. Criminal. I was stealing out of the teacher's pension fund. Went to jail.
Oh, that guy.
That's the guy.
And you know something?
Yeah.
Pat, he's not even on the poll yet. I keep looking over there, and he's not on the poll yet. These guys today, they're just taking a busman's holiday today. I'm flying solo.
He should be
solo.
At the top of the poll.
You're right.
He was on there.
You got it. Thanks a lot, Pally. Have a great weekend.
Bye.
Thanks to Derek.
Well, you faxed it to Eric, but Eric is a little bit slow. He's got bologna sandwiches under each armpit. He's got 14 beef burritos under his chin. In fact, he looks a little like Jerry Lewis today. And he's got a beef burrito with extra beans in his puss right now as we speak. So he's a little tied up, so to speak. But he'll get around to it when he's good and ready. This is exciting. We got the... Oh, you know what?
What?
We do have the clock is back.
Hey.
The dots, the lines are flashing like crazy. WQAM.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
Yes, we have the same internet provider as you guys. We've been down since yesterday, and so have a couple of other businesses in our area.
Brother.
We're over at the library doing our paperwork because we can't do anything online. Not even the dial-up is working.
Isn't that pathetic?
Yeah, and I've talked to some other people who use, you know, companies who lease lines from, and they're also having problems.
Damn it. There's a special place in Purgatory.
It's not your people's fault this time.
Okay,
that's
a first. Thanks a lot, Pally. Good luck to you.
Change.
Okay, see you at the library. Okay, there's a guy. How do you like that? So it's not an internal thing. It was an external, but now how come it came back? But you still don't have the internet up?
No.
Well, I better take a whole lot of calls real fast, like I said, because I got faxes here. I got stories up the ass. But we better just take a lot of calls. In other words, strike while the iron is hot. Remember that saying? I don't know what that means. WQAM. WQAM, hello.
Miserable son of a bitch.
Oh, why does he always come up on line six, I wonder?
One of those things.
WQAM.
Bush and Rumsfeld, Rumsfeld and Bush, Bush and
Rumsfeld. Oh, Rummy and Crummy, huh? Rummy and Dummy. Maybe he's been drinking gin. Rummy. Oh, now look at that. Eight lines flashing frantically, but I don't see line nine flashing. That's disturbing to me. That's my favorite line. WQAM on line one, it's working now. Hello.
Hello. Good
morning, yes, sir.
George Neal.
I beg your pardon?
Good morning.
Good morning. This is Neil Rogers speaking.
Yes, indeed. I want
Star
to wish George happy
scream.
Birthday.
Oh, happy birthday, George, this guy says.
Thank you.
And I hope he gets after the summer book, he should get a very big gift from you, Neil.
Right.
Pat on the head.
A little pat on the head.
Also, one terrible thing about the weather up at during the Marlins, during the Dolphins game this week.
In New England,
yes. Probably not going to get any shots of Tom Brady picking his helmet off on the sidelines.
Damn it.
You realize that.
Well, I'll take a nap and wake up and see what the final score is. Good luck to you, Pally.
Okay, bye-bye.
See ya. That good old Tom Brady, man, he just keeps rolling along. He's losing his hair, though. You better take a look at him right now, all you ladies and fags out there. He looks pretty good to me. Did I see Dan Rather last night? This story was on Silencing Voices of Dissent. Oh, I got to get that on today. Also, this thing about Phil Henry, about ripping Rush on the air last night.
Are you sure?
That's what this guy says, and his caller's calling in pissed off because now his whole audience, most of them are a bunch of right-wing assholes. Good luck to you, Pally.
Okay, bye-bye.
See ya. That good old Tom Brady, man, he just keeps rolling along. He's losing his hair, though. You better take a look at him right now, all you ladies and fags out there. He looks pretty good to me. Did I see Dan Rather last night? This story was on Silencing Voices of Dissent. Oh, I got to get that on today. Also, this thing about Phil Henry.
Play that.
Everybody doing that.
Yeah, I heard Jackson cop the plea. He's going to serve 5 years in a juvenile facility.
All right. Excellent. 45-year-old man sleeping with little boys, and there are those people that are, oh, no, he's the salt of the earth. He never stole a freight train. He's a great guy. He's just an ordinary guy with a funny nose and looks like something out of a goddamn Barbie doll shop. Just look at that, and you
play that.
Everybody's doing that.
Yeah, I heard Jackson cop the plea. He's going to serve 5 years in a juvenile facility.
All right. Excellent. 45-year-old man sleeping with little boys, and there are those people that are, oh, no, he's the salt of the earth. He never stole a freight train. He's a great guy. He's just an ordinary guy with a funny nose.
This is so boring.
What's better than a live radio show every morning on TV? Well, just about anything. But that hasn't stopped MSNBC from teaming up with radio's original bad boy, who now looks like a nasty old lady.
Listen, Bernie.
Imus.
Tell that intern this coffee sucks.
Yes, every morning, see Imus listen to a tape of other people's comedy bits, live on the air.
I need a hammer to bite into this muffin. You somebody have a fresh one, please? Thank you.
See his wild behind-the-scenes antics.
Hey, listen to me, stupid. I am the I-Man. You are the walrus cuckoo-ca-choo. Now get me some fresh coffee or you're fired.
Imus, he's irreverent.
So what's the deal with the Pope?
He's topical.
So what's the deal with this Watergate break?
He's incoherent.
I'll tell you what, that is a government president? What the hell is that? I don't know.
He's
Imus and he's boring.
And he's only on MSNBC, a cable channel nobody watches, and a bunch of AM radio stations nobody listens to.
And when somebody gets some fresh jingle,
it's Imus.
I love it. It's 11:32 at 560. What did you say I have to play?
The Arnold, well, I apologize.
Oh, which one is that?
I don't know what it's called. I don't have a copy of it. They
oh, no, I ran out of paper in my fax machine. Hold on.
No, it's the end of the world.
That's kind of scary.
Yeah.
But then, unlike there, I have an unlimited amount of paper here. I have cases and cases and reams, hairy reams. It's just paper up the ass.
Well, we've got paper.
Anyway, here's silencing voices of dissent. Somebody faxed me. Did you see Dan Rather last night?
No.
Well, as a matter of fact, somehow I missed Danny Boy. This story was on. Activist Brett Bercy has made a profession out of annoying U.S. presidents for nearly 40 years, demonstrating for or against a variety of political causes, but... As CBS News correspondent Lee Cowan reports, while demonstrating during a presidential visit to South Carolina last year, Bercy was arrested and could now be facing up to 6 months in prison. It was the content of my sign that was the problem, said Bercy. A U.S. Secret Service agent told Bercy neither he nor his anti-war poster belonged on a public corner. He said he couldn't be anywhere but in a free speech zone.
What?
You hear that?
I heard it. It's a new thing.
But that so-called free speech zone wasn't outside the hangar where President Bush was speaking. It wasn't across the street, nor was it down the street. It was a half mile away where he couldn't be seen by the president. That's exactly Bercy's point. We are minimalized to the point of being invisible, says Bercy. The invisibility of protest is something that's new under the Bush administration. Few would argue controlling protest is one way to control security. At the Philadelphia convention that nominated Mr. Bush in 2000, demonstrators were fenced in for fear violence would break out, and it did. But an ACLU lawsuit charges the president's free speech zones are so far out of sight, they don't control protest. Instead, they make them disappear. There's nothing more fundamentally un-American than punishing people for the content of their speech, said Chris Hansen of the ACLU. The suit cites more than a dozen instances all across the country where peaceful demonstrators were segregated from the rest of the public. When Mr. Bush's motorcade came through Neville Island, Pennsylvania last year, pro-Bush citizens could line the curb and wave and cheer, but anti-Bush protesters like retiree Bill Neal, were ordered behind a fence out of sight of the president and the press. My moment to speak out was taken away from me, says Neal.
Oh, God.
The Secret Service declined to discuss any specific case or comment on camera, but told CBS News the decisions made in the formulation of a security plan are based on security considerations, not political considerations. Right. Sure they are.
Just remember, America is not a free speech zone.
Firefighters responding to a blaze from three different points in the city all saw the same thick column of black smoke floating into the sky over a junkyard as soon as they left their stations in Fort Lauderdale this morning. 20 cars stacked too high in a 20-foot trailer were on fire in the northwest corner of the Sunrise Sports Car Inc. junkyard on the 900 block of Northwest 19th Avenue, just off Sunrise Boulevard around 9:20 this morning. Just off West Sunrise. Ain't that a shame?
Yep. Shame.
The fire was still burning at 10:30, but firefighters had it under control. Just a little local thing there for it, so we're not out of touch, you know? We don't want to be out of touch like Tom Zicka.
No.
Neil and George, when you have your internet back, no, see, you don't understand it. I got my internet right here. I can look up anything you like, okay? My internet works just fine. Go to worthathousand.com, click on galleries, click on religious shapes too, and down the page you'll find a great picture of Jesus juice. How do you like that?
Fresh squeeze?
Fresh squoze. Jesus juice. Man.
Well, he did turn
says,
water
says, fortunate
white.
For Glenn Campbell, he didn't live in Cincinnati. Oops, he's white. Not to worry, Glenn. Oh. That's right. His bizarre behavior might have instigated a little bit of activity there. Well, they get a little bit upset with people who act like if they're dark and big and fat and appear to be dangerous. Well, that guy's still dead. Good old Nathan. I do like his hot dogs, though. Mike faxes and says perhaps the station should contract DirectWay, broadband satellite internet associated with DirecTV. Right, Mike. He says it's sensational, even faster than the connection we have here at work, and it only took 6 hours to install the dish. Pricey, the service is $100 a month for the first 12 months and then $60 thereafter. I certainly got what I paid for. I'd recommend it to anyone, says Mike. That'd be a great idea, but they won't do it because it costs money. In fact, even our DirecTV, is it working?
No.
I mean, that's another joke. And they always lie about these things. Like, remember the time that Boca Brown was going to FedEx me the disc for that week and come to find out that the station's FedEx account had been closed because they didn't pay their bill? They didn't pay their FedEx bill, and so they closed the account.
You're not supposed to talk about that.
Oh, I see. I don't want to see the Beasleys don't pay their bills, but you know what? The Beasleys don't pay their bills. This is a publicly traded company on a goddamn stock exchange, and they don't pay their bills. Just like George, tomorrow's his birthday. Did he get his bonus yet for the summer book?
No.
No.
Although it's not overdue yet.
Oh, that whole overdue thing, for crying out loud. Jesus God. So anyway, getting back to the Phil Henry thing, here's our really chronic faxers. Has got a chance to catch Phil Henry's show last night. I immediately switched the dial at the sound of the pathetic Panthers hockey. Panthers didn't play last night. So maybe he's like a day, he's a little confused. What is the date on this? It says December 5. He sent it today. Phil was ripping Rush a new ass.
Rectum.
Using words like fat and junky and basically tearing him down. It was also interesting when he opened the phones to regular callers, they began ripping him for his attack on Rush. That's right. How dare you do that? Guess he's stepping a little bit out of line. It says, P.S. Everyone here is going around saying...
About 30, man.
Well, that's good. That's good news. I mean, somebody must be listening. And we're not going to be getting direct way because it costs money. I'm sure it's fabulous and certainly a lot better than the service we already got. That's out. But, you know, it's one of them things. We've been fighting this battle for a hell of a long time. One more great reason out of thousands I can think of right off the top of my head for me not to be there any more than absolutely necessary. Then
absolutely.
Rush Limbaugh, whose credibility took the biggest hit in the past 5 years? Rush 117, Tony Blair 53, Colin Powell 41, Michael Jackson 27, Jesse Jackson 25, Miriam Elephant 19, Pat Riley 6, and Pat Trinolo 2 out of 290 vote. We'll keep that on till noon. By the way, Eric, we'll keep it on till noon. Now, see, if I had a direct connection from here to Eric, then we wouldn't have to worry about that. I could email him.
Well, we could call him. I'll call him.
At noon, we'll put on the other poll. The second poll is going to be, and this will be the one that will be up there on the weekend, so this is the important one, obviously. The first one is just like a dry run, just to kill a couple hours. I got dots, by the way. Stand by. What?
Nothing.
Well, no, we have to grab them while we can get them. WQAM, hello.
Hey.
Yes, sir.
Neil.
How are you?
Hey, listen. The thing was BS.net.
Yeah.
Well, get this one. They're losing people's account information. They did it to me last night. I go in there and try and log in and everything.
Just to kill a couple hours. I got dots, by the way. Stand by. What?
Nothing.
Well, no, we have to grab them while we can get them. WQAM, hello.
Hey.
Yes, sir.
Neil.
How are you?
Hey, listen. The thing was BS.net.
Yeah.
Well, get this one. They're losing people's account. Shout out with your tech support people.
Mm-hmm.
And they're telling me I don't exist either, so I have to, well, how the hell did I log on to chat with you if my email isn't valid?
Sounds like free internet to me.
Yeah, well, it was free internet. Now I don't know what I got, because I'm on the road, and I'll probably go back at the houses and probably pull the phone lines out. Oh, jeez.
Thanks for the good news, pal. They put the BS in BS, man. Hey, good luck to you. You'll need it. Okay, how do you like that?
Oh, that's very
familiar. So now you feel like at least misery loves company. Here's a fax from somebody who says, credibility means someone was once credible. I can't vote for anyone on your list because I don't feel they were ever credible. Based on this criteria, I'd nominate Bill Clinton. He doesn't deserve his new persona created by the opposition. I think he is incredible. What happened to him more closely fits your question as to who's lost the most credibility in the moronic public's eye. Do you buy that?
Huh.
Well, chew on it.
We're Sports Radio 560 QAM.
Politics. Religion, which, by the way, today's the official day, no more religion. His views on South Florida, his taste in music, his taste in movies. I don't agree with anything he says, or I don't disagree with much he says. I think that's a pretty good poll.
There it is.
There's what?
That's a pretty good poll.
Oh. I thought you said, yeah, there it is. I thought maybe your internet was back, and number two went up there like as soon as I said it, which would have been like magic.
I disagree with your sexuality.
Yeah, right. No, I wasn't going to put like my taste in men. You know, that probably not a good idea. Which of these do you most strongly disagree with Neil about? His politics, religion, the Lord made it so, yeah. His views on South Florida, his taste in music, his taste in movies. I don't agree with anything he says, and I don't disagree with much he says. So there's some good choices on there. Now, how come we killed another whole hour here farting around?
Yeah.
What?
Just two more to go, farting around.
No, seriously, we killed a whole hour farting around, and look at that, lines, dots. WQAM.
Yeah, hey, it's Phil from Boca. I've got a spy report for you.
Yes, Phil, you're on right now, Phil.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Lay it on me.
Bring it.
So last night we go to the First Baptist Church.
Wait, wait a minute. It's Paul Harvey Jr.
That's his real name.
Oh, well, we know that. Go ahead.
So anyway, we're at the First Baptist. I wouldn't call if this wasn't important.
Okay.
Because it makes a couple points.
Bring it.
We're at the First Baptist for the Christmas pageant. You know, it's the one they televised internationally. It's got the live animals and all that.
Oy!
So I got dragged to that, and we're seated next to two cameramen. And all of a sudden, one of the cameramen turns to the other and says, "What the hell is he doing here? He must know somebody at the door." Now, who would you imagine would be walking down the center aisle making a big hubbub? Or who would be the last person?
Where was this?
This was at the Baptist Church for...
Rush Limbaugh.
No.
In Palm Beach?
Biggest hoser you know.
Howard David.
Close.
Jeff Rimmer.
Yes.
Really?
No. Jeff Rimmer was at a Baptist church?
For a Christmas pageant.
Free food, right?
No, come on, you're making this up.
I swear as the Lord Jesus Christ is my...
If it's free, it's me. If it's free, it's me. If it's free, it's me.
Yeah, so, you know, yeah, Jesus yelped out a couple of words of Yiddish, so I guess that made it worthwhile.
That's right.
Wow.
But it was just odd. And I guess he was there with his mom, I'm not sure.
With his mom?
I don't know.
Have a good...
day.
Always like that Paul Harvey
talking
Jr.
about? What?
Always like that Paul Harvey Jr.
It wasn't the Rimmer. Rimmer was not at a Baptist church last night. What is this man talking about?
I believe.
Oh, yeah, you like Paul Harvey Jr. now because he's ripping your friend Rimmer. That's why.
Yes.
Taking a cheap shot. WQAM.
Miserable son of a...
Bitch.
WQAM.
Hey, dude.
Yes, sir.
I want to talk about your Paul. I want to say I disagree with everything about you. I mean, I like listening to you, but I think you're a fag. I think you're wrong about religion.
Right.
But I still like listening to you.
Well, let me ask you something. Do you like President Bush?
Bush, he's an idiot.
Oh, well, there you go. So we found something we agree on. Let's hear it.
Yeah.
All right. And Merry Christmas. See, he's just trying to be a hard ass. We found something we agreed on. Plus the fact that this guy that just calls an asshole, we agree on that, right?
Yes.
So there you go.
You're coming together for the holidays.
5670560. We got dots up here on my phone, baby. We got dots. We got dots, dugots, and pans and pots. And Moe's bag. Rots. WQAM.
I can't do it, dude.
Well, this must be Reverend Jones.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was also at a free church, and guess who I saw coming down the aisle?
George Washington. Yeah?
Yeah.
That was it. I think you guessed it right.
Oh, my God, I sure hope he didn't chop down a goddamn altar. That would have been bad. So Jeff Rimmer makes a guest appearance at a Baptist church in Boca last night or somewhere in Palm Beach County. I find that so difficult. In addition to which, his mother's been dead for years, so I don't know what he's talking about.
I think
maybe Paul Harvey Jr. got some of Rush's shipment while Rush is busy making all kinds of denials, while Rush is doctor shopping. Or maybe he's just out fishing like Fredo on a fishing expedition. Oh, my God, I sure hope he didn't chop down a goddamn altar. That would have been bad. So Jeff Rimmer makes a guest appearance at a Baptist church in Boca last night or somewhere in Palm Beach County. I find that so difficult. In addition to which, his mother's been dead for years, so I don't know what he's talking about.
I think
maybe Paul Harvey Jr. got some of Rush's shipment while Rush is busy making all kinds of denials, while Rush is doctor shopping. Or maybe he's just out fishing like Fredo on a fishing expedition. WQAM. Three votes. He's popping it. Tony Blair, 59. Colin Powell, 47. Michael freaking Jackson, 36. Jesse Jackson's got...
about 30, man.
Miriam Elephant, 25. Pat Riley, 9. And Pat Tornello's only got 4, although that guy to call, he had a good point. He wishes it was a lot more than just 4, but that's it. Here's the new poll going up there momentarily. I'm sure that before I even finish reading it again, it'll be on your screen, won't it?
No.
On whose screen?
Well, I didn't tell you how slow I'm going to read it, though.
Oh.
I mean, oh, I got dots. I got dots. WQAM.
Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
I am to see the Rimmer at the congregation's also, Neil.
Yes.
It looked like he was being trailed by the Reverend Jones, the character.
All right. I think they make a cute couple.
Couple of what?
clowns. Which of these do you most strongly disagree with Neil about? His politics? Oh, and look at that. It's up there. Eric, man, you are the best. He probably can hear me now. You think?
No, none.
Well, I got dots. So, see, when I got dots, that means the internet connection's working. It's streaming. It's
squirt.
Pouring out all of our fine verbiage here on the Neil Rogers Show. Do you understand? Here's the schedule, by the way. We got the Humper at 4 after Jim Adage at 2. And then, why am I reading it backwards? Here's the schedule, by the way. We got the Humper at 4 after Jim Adage at 2. And then, why am I reading it backwards? Then you got the Dave Wannstedt Show as part of Hank's show at 5 to 6 this afternoon because it's Friday. And that big game Sunday afternoon in New England, baby, in Foxborough. The Dolphins and the Patriots. See, the Patriots can afford to lose that game, and guess what? They still look pretty good for the division. The Dolphins, for them, if they lose, they really got some tourists, baby. Because if anybody thinks they're... Don't they play the Eagles with Fredo? Same lot of Hail Marys. I mean, in his case, it can't hurt. Democrats want inquiry. See, I'm glad that I have no doubts right now because, you know, it's already 12:20. I've been screwing around. I got too many important things here, too many good bedtime stories. And I, at the risk of making this one of those shows, you know, like we did last year, I don't want to do that no more too much. But these are too important, even though probably nobody cares. Let's see. I wonder, it says, I wonder how many OxyContin pills Rush Limbaugh was taking. I used to be on 2-a-day, and boy, did that ever bind me up. Maybe that's why... That's why he's got such a bad altitude. I had to take a jar of laxatives to unbind me. Oh, by the way, send this guy my mother's phone number.
Okay.
So if Lush was on more than 2-a-day, he had to be a blivet. A blivet is 10 pounds of Schmidt in a 5-pound bag. You'd sure hate to have him around when he blew up. Okay. Also, Ray Denzel says, I wonder if he's kin to Denzel Washington. If so, loan us $50 million, please.
By the way, the Internet's down again.
The Internet's what?
Back off.
Oh. But my dots just came back. How can that be? WQAM? And it shows that I'm on the line, right?
Yeah. Sounds
WQAM, hello.
Miserable son of a...
Bitch. Ray says, I love your show. Stumbled on a website called Thinking Quotes. I'm faxing a few of them. Hope you enjoy. Right up your alley.
Rectum.
The stories are great. Keep up the good work. Here's a bunch of stuff. To surrender to ignorance and call it God has always been premature and remains premature today, said Isaac Asimov, the brilliant science fiction writer. Albert Einstein said, a human being is part of the whole called by us universe, a part limited in time and space. He experiences himself, his thoughts and feelings, as something separated from the rest, kind of an optical delusion of his consciousness, yada, 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 it goes on. In other words, you're born, you live, and you die. Right?
Right.
He also said, my deep religiosity found an abrupt ending at the age of 12 through the reading of popular scientific books. That's what Einstein said. How do you like that? Wow. He says, a man's ethical behavior should be based effectually on sympathy, education, social ties. No religious basis is necessary. Man would indeed be in a poor way if he had to be restrained by fear of punishment and hope of reward after death. Oh, how well said, Albert, good Jewish boy. Margaret Mead said, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever had, said the brilliant anthropologist, she's dead, Margaret Mead. Mark Twain said, I was gratified to be able to answer, what is this? In religion and politics, people's beliefs and convictions are in almost every case gotten at second hand without examination. The Bible has noble poetry in it, and some good morals and a wealth of obscenity, and upwards of a thousand lies. I was gratified to be able to answer promptly, and I did. I said, I didn't know. These are just like isolated quotes. A man is accepted in church for what he believes and turned out for what he knows. That's cute.
Mm-hmm.
Thomas Edison said, you know how dumb he was.
Right, yeah.
Say, hello, hello.
I've never seen the slightest scientific proof of the religious theories of heaven and hell, a future life for individuals, or a personal God. So said someone as ignorant as Thomas Edison.
Yeah, what did
he say? Here you go. They're always trying to tell you, the most brilliant scientists, the most brilliant minds of all time, they believed in God.
No, they did not.
And even the founding fathers. The fathers, they were like deists, which means, it's a pile of crap.
He's there, but he doesn't care.
Right. He's around somewhere.
He's already done his thing.
There's something there like the ozone layer that used to be there, but it ain't no more. I got that story, too, about report warns there's no doubt industry is the primary cause of global warming.
He's starting up again.
New evidence found by, look who wrote this, David Perlman.
Yeah.
He must be kin to Bob Perlman. You don't remember Bob Perlman?
No.
Who was calling me at home? Maybe that was before your time.
Must have been.
Wow. Somebody I went to Michigan State with who was trying to borrow money from me.
I see.
New evidence found by teams of climate researchers leaves no doubt that industrial emissions of greenhouse gases are responsible for increasing global temperatures, an ominous trend that has speeded up in the past 50 years and threatens to continue for centuries, according to a report by two of the nation's leading atmospheric scientists. And, of course, you can see it right here in front of your puss as the weather is so bizarre and strange and weird all over the world now.
It's your imagination.
The two government experts said a climate change may prove to be humanity's greatest challenge and warned that it is very unlikely to be adequately addressed without greatly improved international cooperation and action. Ready for that?
Yeah.
Their published reports, their published comments reflected the growing concerns of most climate experts over the White House stance. Neither scientist criticized the Bush administration's refusal to ratify the Kyoto Treaty, but their published comments reflected the growing concerns of most climate experts over their crappy altitude. Well, cool, there's no such thing as global warming anyway, right?
It's your imagination.
And you can't warm up a plastic turkey.
It's a left-wing eco-Nazi plot.
Democrats want inquiry into reports of Medicare bribe. Lawmaker allegedly offered cash to support prescription drug bill. This should show you about your president bringing morality back to Washington. Right. Democrats and a legal watchdog group have asked Attorney General John Asshole to investigate allegations that Republicans offered a House member $100,000 in contributions for his son's election campaign if he would vote for a Medicare prescription drug benefit passed by Congress last month. Such an offer could be interpreted as a bribe that violates federal law. No Schmidt, Democrats and outside legal experts said. Asshole spokesman Mark Corallo said yesterday that the Attorney General's office will review a letter requesting an investigation from Democratic National Committee Chairman Terry McAuliffe. Melanie Sloan, no relation to Ernie Sloan, behind the velvet rope. Melanie Sloan, Executive Director of Citizens for Responsibility and Ethics in Washington, a nonpartisan legal watchdog group, also wrote Ashcroft demanding an investigation. The attempted bribery and extortion of a member of Congress on the House floor destroys the heart of our democracy, she wrote. I thought that was the game plan, destroying the heart of our democracy.
Yeah.
Though lobbying for support is common during close votes, the Republican successful effort in the wee hours of November 22th stands out for several reasons. GOP leaders held the vote open for nearly 3 hours. House Speaker Dennis Hastert, who customarily leaves partisan arm-twisting to others, was actively involved. So was Cheesehead Tommy Thompson, President Bush's Secretary of HHS, even though cabinet members seldom enter the House or Senate chambers. Media reports have alleged that an undisclosed Republican told Representative Nick Smith, Republican of Michigan, that if he voted for the bill, business interests would contribute $100,000 to help his son Brad succeed him. Smith is not seeking re-election in 2004. His son is one of several Republican candidates running for the seat. Not only was this bribe offered to a member of Congress, it was offered on the floor of the House of Representatives by another member of Congress, McAuliffe wrote to the unctuous Ashcroft. The allegation was first reported November 27th by syndicated columnist the unctuous Robert Novak. Kurt Schmaltz, no relation to Bobby Schmaltz, head of Smith's congressional staff, said Smith confirmed Novak's account is basically accurate. He said Smith had no further comment. How do you like that? Oh, man. The younger Smith said the incident has backfired in his district. A lot of primary voters are disgusted with hardball politics in Washington. Smith did not support the bill. Well, good for him. But he's got sores just because of it. How do you like that?
I don't.
Here's our poll results so far. Which of these do you most strongly disagree with Neil about? We got, well, it just changed again. 109 votes. I don't disagree with anything, he says. 60, 55%. He's a frickin' genius. Wow. His taste in music, 15. Your mama. His politics, 12. His views on South Florida, 10. Religion, 6. His taste in movies, 3. And I don't agree with anything he says, 3. Which means George Duff and Josh Bowden.
Live and local. This is Sports Radio 560. QAM.
You might mention my name to Rice Marshal Gary.
And now, direct from Reich Marshal DeLay's headquarters in Washington, the Jim Baker Singers.
At yourself a fascist little Christmas, with Christians on the rise.
Say hi to the new Republican forthright.
Have yourself a fascist little Christmas, may you find the day. A nigger and tie them to your truck's tailgate. And have yourself a fascist Christmas filled with pain.
Merry Christmas.
have, old General Bohat, I can assure you I will.
Very well. He told the doo-doo.
I don't know.
What is this man doing here?
1232 at 560 WQAM.
Yeah.
Inquirer on here. See, one thing, unlike the good old days or the bad old days, now I'm totally prepared because I know that QM is technically inept at best, and even though this was a BS problem, evidently, there's always some reason, you know, some excuse.
Right. It's Florida.
Is that what it is?
Sure.
Because my internet, my everything here is working hunky-dory, man, fast as lightning. Which, what do we got on the poll now? 160 vote, see? Just take a look over there, and this thing works like, just like that. Like it always does. Drug test for all at Chicago High School. A Catholic high school in Chicago announced plans yesterday to start drug testing all students next fall. This is, it's just amazing. The Chicago Tribune said St. Patrick High School in Chicago, with an enrollment of about 1,000 boys, will become the first Chicago school to require drug tests of all of its students. School officials told the Tribune hair samples from the students will be used to screen for illegal drugs such as marijuana,
oh my God,
cocaine and ecstasy, but not steroids or booze. Oh, I see. So marijuana is bad, but steroids and booze are okay. Parents will be charged $60 for the tests.
I'm just soaking that in. I'm so
Brother Conrad Diebold. Oh, I wonder if he makes them voting machines. President of St. Patrick said the drug screening will help students deal with societal pressures. Right. He told the newspaper, we do know that kids are under pressure, and this gives them a chance to say no and say no with integrity. Students testing positive will not be disciplined, but their parents will be notified. Officially, do you think they'll call the pot police? Officials said a second positive test could result in suspension or expulsion. The Spirit of Christ expels you, man. Well, and, you know, the public, nothing shocks America, man. They just go right around their business. Oh, well, you're just, you know, too worked up, Neil. Just forget about it.
Right.
Okay, forgotten. Trampled Walmart shopper has history of injury claims. Woman has filed 16 previous claims, 9 at Walmart stores. Good. Sue their ass. You go, girl. Whatever her name is, Patricia. Orange City, Florida. A woman reported trampled last Friday by Walmart shoppers desperate for $29.87 DVD players has a long history of claiming injuries from Walmarts and other businesses where she worked or shopped. Good for her. Patricia Van Lester, 41, was knocked unconscious and her sister said, trampled by a herd of elephants by a stampede of shoppers reaching for DVD players that went on sale at 6 a.m. the day after Thanksgiving, according to Orange City Police, and the sister, Linda Elzey. The story was picked up by the AP and carried newspapers and other media as far away as Australia and China, an example. Some commentators have opined of American excess during the holiday shopping season. An investigation by WKMG Local 6 reveals that Van Lester has filed 16 previous claims of injuries at Walmart stores and other places she has shopped or worked, according to Walmart court files and state records. Her sister, who accompanied her Friday on a visit to Walmart, has also filed a prior injury claim against Walmart with Van Lester as her witness, a company. So, in other words, it's a family tag match.
Right.
With Van Lester as a witness, a company spokeswoman said yesterday. Asked whether Van Lester's frequent injury claims might cast doubt on the veracity of her latest allegation, her attorney, David L. Sweat of Port Orange, said, no sweat. No, he said, no comment. He did stress, though, that Van Lester has not filed a claim, nor have we decided to file one related to last week's incident. Walmart is reviewing store videotapes. They've called up Warner Wolf. Let's go to the videotape. As we look into the claim, spokeswoman Karen Burke said from the massive retailer's Bentonville, Arkansas headquarters, we'll investigate this claim as thoroughly as we have the other 10 claims that this customer and her sister have brought against our stores in the past. Boy, what a racket. It's like the slip and fall con artists.
Right.
See, some people don't really understand that there are such people.
Yes, there are. They're called
gypsies.
There
are people who survive, who make a living mm-hmm. by going into, like, supermarkets. And what they'll do is they'll, like, they'll take, like, a jar of mayonnaise or something.
Mm-hmm.
And while nobody is looking, they'll, like, smear a little bit on the floor or something like that. Or they'll break something and, like, smear it on the floor. And then they'll, oh, my God, my back, you know, and then make sure they got somebody with them as a witness. And then they sue for millions.
Right.
And the fact of the matter is that most of the time, big chains, at any rate, will settle out of court because they don't want the hassle and the expense of going to court. So, okay, here you go. Here's $50,000. Here's $100,000. I had a friend. I didn't know the people, but he had a husband and wife, a couple, who made their living by doing slip and falls in Detroit. Ready for that?
Yeah, no, I know all about it.
That was their livelihood. What do you mean, right, you know all about it?
You hear stories, you see shows, that kind of thing. You meet gypsies.
Oh, gypsies?
Sure. They know all
of
them.
The ones who repave your driveway?
There's a book. It's a big book, like a giant encyclopedia of all of these scams, and they do them all.
Well, see, up until you started telling me about the gypsy stuff, I never realized that gypsy, the guy that does my driveway.
Yeah.
Every year or two, he comes around. No, listen to me.
I'm sorry, I know. You told me that.
He does the tar job, you know?
Yeah,
and he does a good job. And he doesn't soak me an arm and leg. It doesn't cost, I don't know, 70 or 80 bucks, whatever it is. And he puts down the new tar, and it does a great job, and that's it.
Shouldn't
I don't care if he's a gypsy or what he is. He does a good job.
If he does a good job, why do you do it every other year?
Well, whenever the hell, maybe I don't do it every year. Well, you know, the wear and tear and all that other crap. Maybe he's not doing such a good job. Why, how often should you repave your driveway?
I don't know, like every 10 years?
Get out of here.
Right. About 30, man.
10 years, my ass.
Okay.
Well, plus he's a nice guy, you know.
Sure, of course they are.
He's a nice gypsy.
I don't know if he's a gypsy.
Old and ugly.
He might be an Irish traveler.
Oh, that could be it, too. See, there's a whole bunch of things. Or he might just be an honest businessman trying to make an honest buck, and you're just a hard ass pick. That's
right.
Always looking for some angle. Always looking for some reason that you don't like this one or that one.
That's right.
Anyway, we got that story about the... I think we're going to play stuff on it, too. I think that was an excellent idea. Well, we have no dots. We have a bonus bits hour. We'll play like Mo Howard Davidson stuff, which that guy wanted to hear the other day.
Right.
And we got like all that Christmas stuff, like that one I just played about the fascist effing Christmas. Right?
Right.
I mean, what else are we going to do? I mean, I could sit here and talk, and I feel like I've been out here for 20 hours today. Ordinarily, this thing zips by like you wouldn't believe. But today, I feel like I've been doing about a 40-hour marathon because half the time you spend looking up there to see if you got any dots. I got, like, dots dancing in front of my eyelids right now from just looking at that stupid screen. And then you have no Internet. See, that's another thing. You say, if I was there, I could take the calls, but we'd have no poll today.
Right. Eric could fax it to you.
Yeah, wouldn't that be great, like old days again? That was pathetic. Remember that?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah, well, back before we had, before I spent the money to get a computer in there, we used to have Eric, we'd take the poll, and Eric used to have to fax me the results. Or when I was there and the damn thing would go down every 5 minutes, he'd have to fax me the results because the Internet connection there sucks. Which of these do you most strongly disagree with, Neil? About 176 votes. I don't disagree with much, he says, 91. His taste in music, 28. His politics, 19. His views on South Florida, which I hate like poison, by the way, 16. Religion, 12. I don't agree with anything he says, 7. But they're listening. You're listening. And, last but not least, his taste in movies, 3. I guess maybe Miguel was one of those who voted on that. Miguel, you're a nice guy. You look good and all the other stuff, but you're clueless, man. If Fidel would have just made a cameo appearance during Requiem for a Dream, he'd have loved it. If Sarah would have just one time said, say, how about you now?
I think it was at that party, though.
He was at what party?
The party at the end.
Oh, yeah. The ass-to-ass party?
Yeah. The end-to-end party.
Mm-hmm.
Rectum.
It's a great movie. It's one of the greatest of all time, and I don't care what you say, Magnolia. I'm going to rewatch Magnolia this weekend. I'm going to put it on my calendar right now.
All good.
I don't care what anybody says. Okay. I love Magnolia. It's
good.
Just... It, what?
You can have
See, now you're finally admitting you don't even like it.
I did like it, up until it didn't end.
What?
Up until the non-end, I liked it
a lot.
Oh,
you mean like Fargo?
Fargo ended.
Yeah, real abrupt-like. Like
yeah,
they couldn't think of anything else to do.
But it came to an end. They caught him, and it's over.
Yeah. Zip! That was it. Like, there you go, that's the end of the movie. It's like they ran out of film. Oh, we're almost at the end of the reel. Let's not waste another one. Anyway, it was a good movie. I liked it. I like William H. Macy, although I think his performance in Magnolia was better.
I agree.
He was great. And who's the guy from Laughing?
Ronan Martin.
No, seriously, the guy that played the fag in the bar. I mean, that scene, of course, to me...
Oh, you know his name, I don't.
Oh, Christ, I can't think of his name.
Ah,
that was
Artie
a great
Johnson.
Scene. No. Oh, man. I'm going to have to run in the other room and get the movie out, damn it.
Go ahead, I'll play something.
I don't have it. I loaned it to somebody.
Ah, damn it.
1,700 U.S. soldiers quit Iraq, says the French magazine. What French magazine? Oh, La Canard.
Le Frog.
Le Canard. 1,700 U.S. soldiers, that's 1,700 sounds like to me, have deserted their post in Iraq, with many of them failing to return to military duty after getting permission to go back to the U.S., according to the French weekly magazine Le Canard Enchant. The magazine, known for its satires and expos, the French are disgusting. They really are. And if you go to Montreal, man, if you don't speak French, they're just as bad as in Paris. They'll look at you up. Parlez-vous get lost? They hate you. The magazine, known for its satires and exposés, said the French intelligence agency got the information from what it described as an American colleague setting a senior French official posted in Washington. The magazine also said that 7,000 U.S. soldiers have left Iraq allegedly due to psychological troubles and other illnesses. Some 2,200 others sustained serious injuries, including the loss of limbs, it said. Well, I'm glad they're giving us those stats because, of course, the U.S. doesn't give injury statistics because it's too embarrassing and depressing. And speaking of embarrassing, this worked out good. Catholic Church in Ireland releases study of sexual abuse by priests. Roman Catholic bishops, doubling their pleasure, released a damning report on their handling of child sex abuse scandals, apologized yesterday, and promised to improve systems for protecting children. Anybody buy it?
No.
The 332-page report, the fruit of 2 years of work by psychologists at the Royal College of Surgeons in Ireland, detailed the damage the scandals have done to victims, the church, and wider society in this overwhelmingly Catholic nation of Ireland. But a lot of those pasty Irishmen and women. This study makes painful reading, not least for a bishop, said Archbishop Sean Brady, no relation to Tommy, president of the Irish Bishops Conference and leader of Ireland's 4 million Catholics. It tells of mistakes made in responding to those who came to the church seeking sensitivity and compassion. They sought sensitivity and compassion. You know what the church gave them instead? Right. A smack in the head. More than 100 Irish clergy have been convicted of sex offenses in the last decade. The scandals toppled a government in 1994 after the Irish Attorney General delayed extradition of a priest wanted on sex abuse charges in neighboring Northern Ireland, where they're busy killing each other all the goyim. A compensation tribunal formed earlier this year is expected to pay up to $700 million to thousands of claimants who allegedly suffered abuse in church-run schools, workhouses, and orphanages from the 1940s to the 80s. The government agreed to foot most of the bill because it had the ultimate responsibility for supervising the institutions. And then it goes on about pledging to do this and pledging to do that, yada, yada, yada. Researchers surveyed 1,081 citizens by phone and conducted face-to-face interviews with 7 victims of molestation, 8 clergymen convicted of sex abuse crimes. And it's got all kinds of stats, and they did this, and they did that. Some 65% said they'd be happy if their child became an altar server. See, they don't call them altar boys. They're an altar server.
Because they have girls now.
And 56% they'd be happy if their son would become a priest. Ready for that?
No.
Me either. I'll tell you what I am ready for, though.
Live and local.
Big one, 2 hours.
560.
The radio's all yours now.
QAM. Buttheads. It's the 1 to 2 hour. It's the wonderful world of science with Professor Moe.
Hello there, boys and girls. Today, we're going to learn about an invisible substance incident. And it ain't got nothing to do with fluids and juices, so you don't have to worry about it. As a matter of fact, it's a night. That's right, boys and girls. It's a noble gas named for Ray Noble and his orchestra. Now, to demonstrate our...
Hiya, Mo.
Why, Geldy, what a surprise. Pray tell. What brings you here?
I want to learn about gas.
It's a noble gas, you moron.
Ow.
Now, here. Hold this tube. Not the one in my pants. Ah, not wonder what you got handed in.
Sorry.
You ruined my whole day. Why, yeah, you're...
Listen.
What?
That sound.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
Noble gas. Now get out of here, you little pitcher, before
I... Wait a minute, Mo. I got something for you.
What do you got there?
A bag of potatoes.
Potatoes? For what?
You can make a battery out of a potato.
A battery out of a potato, huh?
Yeah. Now pull down your checkered pants.
Ah, no, you don't. What do you think? I'm some kind of maroon.
Come on, Mo. You need a conductor.
All right. There. Now what are you...
Not working yet.
How'd that make it work? I turned it up my ass.
Up the butt. Up the butt. Up the butt. Up the butt.
Dead, dead, dead. Someday you'll be dead. Dead, dead, dead.
Oh!
Someday we'll all be dead.
Are you sure?
Yes.
The minute we're born, we start dying. We die a little more every day. Young or old, rich or poor, there's nothing we can do to stop it. So look long at that Christmas tree. It may be the last one that you see. Decorate your house in green and red, 'cause someday you'll be dead. Dead, dead, dead. Someday you'll be dead. Dead, dead, dead. Someday we'll all be dead. It might happen in a couple months or 50 years from now. But no matter when it happens, it will seem too soon to you. So be sure on Christmas Eve when you snuggle into bed that you thank God for your family, 'cause someday they'll be dead. Dead, dead, dead. Someday they'll be dead. Dead, dead, dead. Someday we'll all be dead. Who knows how many Christmases are left in their short life? Nobody knows, that's my point. Enjoy them while you can. And so on Christmas morning, let good tidings fill your head. What a festive season. Someday you'll be dead. Dead, dead, dead. Someday we'll be dead. Dead, dead, dead. Everyone you know, dead. A very merry Christmas to you. Dead, dead,
each impediment. Christmas joy they're barely bringing, carols through their noses singing. Jesus truly did us wrong when he made them sing this song.
What do you mean?
Hark, the hare-lipped angels sing.
But critics agree, this collection of holiday songs may very well be the most moving and memorable of all time.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, just like the ones I used to know.
Yes, Candle Wax Music presents Elmer Fudd's Christmas Classics. And this 24-record set is truly incredible.
Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Hey.
Oh, what fun you'll have hearing these timeless classics performed by America's most beloved hunter of wabbits.
Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer had a very shiny nose. And if you ever saw it, you would even say it was.
Elmer Fudd's Christmas Classics, not available in stores. And when you receive your set in the mail, you'll know why.
Hello, everybody. I sure hope you like my Christmas Classics.
So call toll-free 1-800-FUDD. Operators are standing by.
Santa Claus is coming to town.
You've heard him sing on Ally McBeal. And now, Robert Downey Jr. sings just for you. A collection of Robert Downey Jr. holiday classics. This Christmas, I'm on the crack pipe. Again. Well, the judge has been so damn spiteful, just because I had a pipe full. But, Your Honor, I've got to go. Buy some blow, buy some blow, buy some blow. Cutting through my coke with a rusty razor blade. Lots of pots of smoke, trying to evade. The cops all dressed in blue, patting down my jeans. Good thing for me that I swallowed my amphetamines. It's the most wonderful time of the year. There'll be hookers aplenty as I pop a penny, chased down with a beer. It's the most wonderful time of the year.
Robert Downey Jr.'s Christmas Crackpipe.
On the streets of Los Angeles at 2:45 a.m. I hide the rock down in my sock. I just bought 7 of them.
It's a holiday album for the entire crack house.
I'll be in jail for Christmas.
All right.
You'll also hear Little Druggy Boy, I Saw Santa Breaking Several Laws, and Deck the Halls with Boughs of Pot Plants, with special appearances by Charlie Sheen, Brett Butler, Willie Nelson, and many other celebrities who've ruined their careers. The Robert Downey Jr. Christmas Album.
What are you doing this year? Me? I'll be in jail for Christmas.
You know Dancer and Prancer and Dasher and Vixen, Comet and Cupid, Donner and Blitzen. But do you recall the most famous reindeer of all?
Yes.
Rudolph the well-hung reindeer had a very lengthy hose, and when he got excited, it stuck out way past his nose. All of the other reindeer wondered why the sled wouldn't go. Turns out that Rudy's organ was getting stuck in the snow. Then one foggy Christmas Eve, Mrs. Santa came to say, Rudolph, with your tools so long, won't you drive me all night long? All of the reindeer hate him. He's the favorite one because Rudolph the well-hung reindeer gets to bang Mrs. Claus.
On tonight's Action News.
Action News.
The Michael Jackson interview.
The most loving thing to do is to share your bed with someone.
What else do you share with the children?
My nose, thighs, my lower torso, my buttocks, my penis.
On tonight's Action News. Who are the last four people you had sex with?
Brooke Shields, Diana Ross, Manuel Lewis, and Bubbles.
So Tracy and Kendall says Henry Gibson was in Magnolia, and you're right. Thank you, Tracy. And she says he was great, and have a great day, and you too.
Yes, he was. Now?
I beg your pardon?
I said, yes, he was. He was hysterical.
I'm assuming that we're going to have the other 160 bucks, so we need 135 bucks more for 44,000 from Joe and Mark.
Really?
In other words, they never called again?
Did they call again, Josh?
I haven't got an update.
Oh, my. Well, what do you mean update? They're gone. They're done. Hey, join Joe and Mark 11 to 1 today. Oops. That's Eastern time, not Central. They're gone. So in other words, they raised 20. Now the last time they went on did that, they raised 20 bucks. Well, how can they raise 25? What do we have that's 25 bucks?
Sandy gave that money.
Oh, I see. So in other words, she just gave a donation.
I mean, she might have taken a CD. I don't know, but she gave.
But she gave him 25 bucks. So in other words, it was one piece again, just like last time. Well, at least they may not be great, but they're consistent. There's something bad going on there, man. With that whole deal.
Hey,
we appreciate their efforts. You can't complain about their efforts because,
Miguel anyway, called. We got 65 bucks. 25 of it was from your neighbor.
Okay, 65 bucks. So that's another 40. So that's 905. 43,905. So that means we need another 95 bucks for 44 grand. We'll certainly get that between 4 and 6 this afternoon with Miguel, right?
Oh, yeah. Because, right, yeah.
Well, no, what are you talking about? Miguel does okay, not like we used to in the old days, but then again, it's tough for raising money now, plus we have no audience. But 4 to 6, the van will be at Hollywood Chrysler Jeep, 2100 North State Road 7, just north of Sheridan Street. And then tomorrow, after your two great appearances, we got to have like $1 million.
Yeah, right.
And you can have part of it. 12 minutes past 1 at 560 WQM. By the way, I have no dots. I just mentioned that. Not that we're taking calls this hour anyway, but I just mentioned that in passing. Nobody thinks we're just screwing off. I got no dots. Hey, if you want to give your home a new style this holiday season by replacing that tired old carpeting, here's a great idea. Laminates are us. They're the easy, low-maintenance alternative to expensive natural wood flooring. Laminates R Us is the best place to find laminated wood flooring from the top names in the universe, because they got them all. They got Pergo, Peridor, Wilson Art, Unifloor, Quickstep, and all of Laminates R Us flooring is installed by Pergo-certified installers who really know their stuff. Here's another reason to call Laminates R Us. Their prices are so low, it'll probably floor you. Right now, get their holiday special for just $1,495. That's for up to 295 square feet of beautiful laminate wood flooring. It is absolutely
unbelievable.
And Laminates R Us will match any legitimate written offer, too. So if you'd like to get yourself a free in-home estimate and find out just what a great deal it is, call Laminates R Us today toll-free at 1-877-777-3336. They make it so simple it's a piece of cake. They give you free carpet disposal, free furniture moving, a 25-year warranty. So this holiday season, give your home a gift, a new style with beautiful laminated wood flooring from our friends at Laminates R Us. Call them toll-free today and tell them that cranky old Neil told you to call 1-877-777-3336. That's 1-877-777-3336.
Sports Radio 560 QAM.
I hate this place. Nothing works here.
No.
The medications don't work.
No.
I've been here for 7 years. Nothing works here. I hate this place. Nothing works here. The medications don't work. I've been here for 7 years. I hate this place. Nothing works here.
Coming up tonight on Inside the Behind, the True Hollywood Celebrity Music Biography Profile Story. They wrote the theme song to The Sopranos, and we've never heard from them again. Tonight, we go looking for Alabama 3. I woke up this morning,
got myself a girl. Alabama 3? I never heard of him.
A legitimate New Jersey businessman who wants to be known only as a Guido.
Hey, that's Guido, not a Guido. That makes it sound generic. You trying to reduce me to a cultural stereotype, you Ivy League pr***?
I'm sorry. Do go on.
Like I was saying, I don't know from Alabama 3. What I do know is they write this song, and suddenly certain criminal elements of our society are in the spotlight again, and they are not happy. And maybe they would like to kill Alabama 3 in a painful way, and be willing to pay handsomely for it, too.
With good money riding on it, we began our search for Alabama 3. A band formed in London, England, by nightclub DJ Larry Love, whose real name was Robert Sprague. We soon found Robert Sprague's father.
Alabama 3? No, mate, no. My son Robert, I don't even have a son. Never could. Low sperm count. Wife hates me for it, but what can you do?
Dad, who are you talking to?
Oh, for Christ's sake, Robert, get back in the secret room.
But I'm tired of...
Go on, you stupid nit... That was nothing, doesn't it all?
It may indeed have been nothing. But to us, it looked a lot like the man behind Alabama 3 was hiding like a frightened little girl in his father's basement. So we did what any respectable journalist in need of quick cash would do. We let Guido know about it.
Hey, we know he's in there, you old freak!
Go away!
Up here!
Run!
Well... Whatever happens next. We never had this conversation, though I make myself clear. It's a big, juicy, sopping wet look at show business. Tonight, on Inside the Behind.
Car theft is on the rise. In America, a car is stolen every 12 seconds. What can you do to protect your car? An expensive car alarm system won't protect your car from being stolen. The club won't protect the valuables inside your car. But a big black guy named Ben can.
Get away from the car, motherfucker.
For less than you'd pay for an expensive car alarm system, and even less than you'd pay for the club, you can get a big black guy named Ben to protect your automobile.
Get away from the car, motherfucker.
It's simple to use. Just leave the big black guy named Ben in your car whenever you get out, and he does the rest. Whenever anyone gets within 6 feet of your car, Ben simply gets out of the car and tells them,
get away from the car, motherfucker.
Listen to these testimonials from people who use a big black guy named Ben.
It's always nice to have someone to ride with, although he really doesn't say much, just,
get away from the car, motherfucker.
That's about it. I didn't get a big black guy named Ben to chat with. I got him to protect my car. It's the best investment I've ever made.
My neighborhood isn't that great. There have been a lot of car thefts. I can't tell you how many times I've heard...
Get away from the car, motherfucker.
Knowing that I've got a big black guy named Ben protecting my car lets me sleep better at night.
Call now, 1-800-1-BIG-GUY. That's 1-800-1-B-I-G-G-U-Y. And instead of hearing this, you'll hear this.
Get away from the car, motherfucker.
While spending the remainder of your golden years in the land of death, the one thing you have to depend on is your car. With Jew Canoe theft on the rise, the people who brought you a big black guy named Ben car alarm now bring you an old Jewish guy named Eisen.
Get away from my automobile, you big MF.
Remember when we used to boost it back at Caribbean?
Yeah,
we ought to get a bundle for this, baby. Yeah. The white ones are cooler.
Yeah. Get away from my automobile, you big MF.
What the hell is that?
I object seriously to profanity like that.
Slow down, I think somebody's coming.
Get away from my automobile, you big MF. Get away from my automobile, you big MF.
Whenever some bastard tries to steal my car, I feel safer with an old Jewish guy named Eisen.
Get away from my automobile, you big MF.
Get your old Jewish guy named Eisen car alarm now and receive a free flower antenna.
Get away from my automobile, you big, big MF.
An old Jewish guy named Eisen car alarm, now available at all Zehr stores.
Heard there is no Christmas in the silly Middle East. No trees, no snow, no Santa Claus. They have different religious beliefs. They believe in Muhammad and not in our holiday. And so every December I go to the Middle East and say,
hey there, Mr. Muslim, Merry fucking Christmas. Put down that book, the Koran, and here's some holiday wishes. In case you haven't noticed, it's Jesus' birthday. So get off your heathen Muslim ass and fucking celebrate.
There is no holiday season in India, I've heard. They don't hang up their stockings, and that is just absurd. They never read a Christmas story, they don't know what Rudolph is about. And that is why in December I'll go to India and shout.
Hey there, Mr. Hinduist, Merry fucking Christmas. Drink eggnog and eat some beef and pass it to the missus. In case you haven't noticed, it's Jesus' birthday. So get off your heathen Hindu ass and fucking celebrate.
Now I heard that in Japan, everyone just lives in sin. They pray to several gods and put needles in their skin. On December 25th, all they do is eat a cake. And that is why I go to Japan and walk around and pray.
Hi there, Mr. Shintoist! Merry f***ing Christmas! God is gonna kick your ass, you infidelic pagan scum! In case you haven't noticed, there's festive things to do! So let's all rejoice for Jesus! Merry f***ing Christmas, you!
On Christmas Day, I travel around the world and say,
Jewish, Christmas, Buddhist, and all you atheists too! Merry f***ing Christmas to you!
I'm seething like a wise Christian about the Jews and gay homos. How I'd love to bury those Christ-killing fairies who don't know the Bible like I know. I'm seething like a white Christian, and how we all must think and act alike, and not to think whenever it's appropriate. Yes, wouldn't it be wonderful if everybody in the world was white and Christian and looked the same and
no.
said the same things. Boring? I don't think so. No, to me, that would be paradise and the Republican way. I seething like a white Christian. And how we all must think alike. All the gays, black and Yitlach, must die.
Oi!
Until everybody's Christian and
white!
125, I don't know who agrees with that.
That affected the economy.
Yeah, it sure did. Anyway, I got some good news for you. I should mention also, thanks for the picture.
Yeah.
That brought back a lot of memories, most of them bad. Warren Eugene. Oh, this is from Toronto, no less. Norma Kent emailed me this. Warren Eugene, a pioneer of internet gambling, sees a lucrative new online frontier in a Canadian law that allows people with certain illnesses to grow and smoke their own marijuana.
All right.
Eugene, 43, says his firm, Amagula Medical Cannabis, Inc., plans to grow and sell the drug to people authorized to use it for medical purposes and perhaps to some people not medically authorized. He wants Amagula Medical to become an international publicly listed concern. This flower power has a new opportunity for resurgence. He said, this is what really interested me. He spends most of his time in the Bahamas, Mon, said from his Toronto hotel room. Eugene, a Canadian and definitely no hippie, says he never smoked pot, is not interested in the grassroots movement to legalize the drug, but he sees a money-making opportunity. His venture is being funded with $5 million of his own money. He wants to raise another $7 million from investors. It will initially target medical users, but Eugene says the market could grow if Canada confirms legislation currently under review that would mean the possession of up to 15 grams of cannabis, just over half an ounce, would not be a criminal offense. This plant, cannabis, has such a fragrance that it's ready to bloom and bleed into the marketplace, so to speak, and produce an elaborate and remarkable return for investors, said Eugene, who founded the first internet casino, too. Well! In other words, this isn't some fly-by-night asshole. This is a guy who knows his crap. Huh?
A man of vision.
A man of vision. By the way, we'll give you the address a little later on.
So it's only certain illnesses?
Yeah, like headaches.
Oh, okay. Like tired. Thinning hair.
Unhappy.
Shortness.
Right. Bored. 27 past 1 at 560 WQAM. Big news. Hamlet Pontiac GMC is now Auto City Pontiac GMC of Pinecrest. Our dear close personal friend Tom Lehman has sold the dealership to Lomberto Perez of Auto City Buick Pontiac GMC of Homestead. He used to play first base for the Reds. Expect the same great Neil deals and customer satisfaction you're accustomed to as Hallett's longtime general manager Joe Prieto is still there at the controls. Stop by Auto City Pontiac GMC of Pinecrest for those great Neil Rogers deals on all makes and models in stock. And right now you can take advantage of 0% financing for up to 72 months or save yourself up to $9,000, nine big ones, with rebates and incentives too. That's right, you heard right, Neil deals are continuing at the new Auto City Pontiac GMC of Pinecrest. Only the name has been changed to protect the guilty parties. The same location, of course, 13401 South Dixie Highway. That's US 1 across from the falls, open every day, 7 days a week. For more info on those unbeatable Neil Rogers Neil Deals, call the Neil Deal Hotline. Say it again, the Neil Deal Hotline, toll-free, 1-888-543-4211. That's 1-888-543-4211. All offers subject to credit approval. See the folks at Auto City Pontiac GMC for details. That's the brand-new and exciting Auto City Pontiac GMC of Pinecrest. Low prices without the high pressure.
This is Sports Radio 560 QAM.
Get Bush.
America's favorite couple, Nick Lachey and Jessica Simpson, celebrate the season MTV style in A Newlyweds Christmas.
I'm Nick Lachey.
And I'm Jessica Simpson. And it's time to deck the malls with brows of jolly.
Nick and Jessica invite you into their home to trim the tree.
Jess, what are you doing?
I'm watering the tree, baby.
But it's an artificial tree.
Sometimes I am such a ditz, I should be using artificial water.
Oh my God.
Listen as they tell the story of Christmas to a group of adorable children.
That first Christmas night, the shepherds marveled at the sight of baby Jesus.
Uh-huh, because they knew if Jesus saw his shadow, there'd be six more weeks of winter.
And join the newlyweds in singing their favorite Christmas carols.
Can't you see that she's dum-dum-dum-dum?
But he still married me. I'm dum-dum-dum-dum.
Come celebrate the holidays with the little dumber girl and her Saint Nick. A Newlyweds Christmas.
trouble, Apple Records comes to me, begging to remaster, let it be. 'Cause if we strip it naked, then the Beatles have a new CD. You must buy it once more, it's not free. Let it be, let it be, let it be, yeah. These old songs, there's still plenty more we can release. Thank you all for helping feed our greed. If you try to steal our music by downloading MP3s, you'll hear from our lawyers. Wait and see. Wait and see.
Sells a corporate war that runs a bum. Never fought in a war that runs a bum. A sissy chicken hawk that runs a bum. Picks his ass when he walks that runs a bum. Rummy's a bum, Rummy's a bum, a walking stroller, a bum, a bum, a bum. Hill of brown and roof, that Rummy's a bum, a bum, a bum. Hamelin pharmaceuticals, that Rummy's a bum. Aerospace, that Rummy's a bum. I'd like to slap his face, that Rummy's a bum. Rummy's a bum, Rummy's a bum. Corporate scum. G.D. Cyril and Tribune, that Rummy's a bum. Wrapped in a suit that Rummy's a bum. Wears garters on his socks that Rummy's a bum. He's butch like Wally Cox that Rummy's a bum. Rummy's a bum, Rummy's a bum. Who likes his butt tongue?
Today's fast-paced world holds its share of headaches.
Hey, there's a thumbprint on this report. Do it again.
Yes, sir.
You got a problem?
No, sir.
Under some pressure, huh?
Yeah, it feels like my head's gonna explode, and aspirin doesn't do anything.
Well, here, take some ibuprofen.
Ibuprofen? Well, I'll try anything. That dirty, rotten son of a... Who the f*** does he think he's talking to? I ought to make that little do his own report.
Feel better?
Yeah, what's in ibuprofen?
Well, nothing we can admit to on the radio except our secret ingredient, Screw 'em All, which eliminates any inhibitions you might have about saying what's on your mind. Hey, uh-oh, here comes your boss.
Look, I want this report done, even if you have to work through your lunch hour, okay?
Listen, numbnuts, when are you going to get off your ass and do some work around here?
Well, I see you take ibuprofen.
Yeah.
I take it too, you lazy piece of
Oh, listen.
Now get off the copier.
Ibuprofen. Use only as directed.
Timeless is so boring.
What's better than a live radio show every morning on TV? Well, just about anything. But that hasn't stopped MSNBC from teaming up with radio's original bad boy, who now looks like a nasty old lady.
Listen, Bernie.
Imus.
Tell that intern this copy sucks.
Yes, every morning, see Imus listen to a tape of other people's comedy bits, live on the air.
I need a hammer to bite into this muffin. Yeah, somebody give me a fresh one, please. Thank you.
See his wild behind-the-scenes antics.
Hey, listen to me, stupid. I am the Iman. You are the walrus cuckoo ca-choo. Now get me some fresh coffee or you're fired.
Imus. He's irreverent.
So what's the deal with the Pope?
He's topical.
So what's the deal with this Watergate race?
He's incoherent.
I'll tell you what, that is a double president? What the hell is that? I don't know.
He's
Imus and he's boring.
And he's only on MSNBC, a cable channel nobody watches, and a bunch of AM radio stations nobody listens to.
Yeah, but somebody get some fresh jingle.
It's Imus.
Kind of like that Don Cilio in Orlando, you know, AM stations that nobody listens to, kind of the same thing. I know I played that before, but I could play that many times a day.
Over and over, man.
And still wouldn't be enough for me. I love it. 279 votes on the poll. Which of these do you most strongly disagree with Neil about? I don't disagree with much, he says. 139. 49.8%. Boy, that is my flock. His taste in music, 53. His politics, 27. His views on South Florida, 21. Religion, 18. I don't agree with anything he says, a dozen, the dirty dozen, but they're listening. And his taste in movies, only 9. Not too bad. So let's see. Norma Kent is pledging $250 for Bandit Pet Rescue. So I'll put that in the deal here. Let's see. In fact, you should call. Where is he going to mail that? Is he going to mail it to us?
He has all our addresses. He can mail it to my attention here at the station.
Yeah, mail it to QM. You got the address. You've been there a couple of times to George's attention, because then we'll handle it. It'll make it like more official for our total. 44,155 with Norma's $250. So we're over 44. We'll make it to 50 grand. It's only the 5th of December, right? Right. And especially with a lot more than Joe and Mark appearances, that should really put us over the top. Oh, man, what is their story? Anyway, George is going to do better. Tomorrow afternoon, noon to 2, George will be... You won't?
No.
George will do worse. But it's your birthday tomorrow. Go by and wish George a happy birthday. And bring him a big fat one and a check, too, for Abandoned Pet Rescue. George will be noon to 2 tomorrow. Lauderdale Imports BMW, 1400 South Federal Highway in Fort Lauderdale. Food from Atlantic City Subs. Get there early for the free food. And he'll zip right over from 3 to 5 tomorrow at Lauderdale BMW at Pembroke Pines at 14,800 Sheridan Street. Food from Atlantic City Subs. Again, and all of our best deal merchandise for a really good cause in spite of what that asshole said. That guy needs to, you know what they need to do? They need to take him and introduce him to that kid in Pompano Beach and have the kid throw his ass in front of the cars. What do you say to that?
Okay. All right.
I like it. Well, they say Andy Williams used to sing It's the Most Wonderful Time of the Year back when Andy was still just barely alive, but a lot of people don't agree because they hate the crowded malls, the long register lines, the crowded traffic, the parking hassles, all of these things. So this year, make your gift giving a little bit easier for you and the ones you love. Just a gift certificate from Dollar Mattress is all you need. Just that one simple call again to 1-800-MATTRESS and give the gift. They'll be thanking you in year in and year out, night in and night out. Dollar Mattress has got gift certificates in any denomination. And the new Bedford Master Bedroom makes a perfect gift you'll both enjoy for years to come. At Dollar Mattress, no phony promises, no bait and switch, just discount prices every day on the brand names you know, trust, and love, including now Stearns and Bananas Foster. Dollar Mattress has the guaranteed lowest prices anywhere on Stearns and Foster Hewitt. When you call Dollar Mattress at 1-800-MATTRESS, you pick the day and time for delivery, and you know how it works, any two-hour window, 8 to 10 in the morning until 10 at night. What does that mean? In other words, like between noon and 2, 1 and 3, when it's convenient for you and it'll actually show up on time, take away the crappy, smelly, nasty, soiled old bedding and set up your brand new one. You can't beat it. Honest sales practices, fantastic service, everyday low prices, same-day delivery, and free setup and removal. All of these things make Dollar Mattress number one in customer satisfaction. You'll agree with me. For service like you only dream about, call the bedding experts at Dollar Mattress, 1-800-MATTRESS, 1-800-MATTRESS, or check them out online at mattress.com. Happy holidays from your friends at Dollar Mattress.
Live and local, we're Sports Radio 560 QAM.
Howard David's a bitch.
Forget about it. That's what I say. How's that for a funny show idea? If I may borrow a phrase from the great Marty Allen, hello there, everybody in Paradise Land. I'm Howard David. I hope you'll join me each and every Friday for my Forget About It show. That's when I open the phone lines to all three of my regular low-income callers and let them vent on what's bothering them. I was up all night dreaming this one up. At first, I thought of going with hand puppets like Sandy Becker, or maybe a poll to vote for Quiz for Quake. But management and I agree, this will be a real showstopper. Now, I run a family-type show here, so I don't want no references to sticks, jigaboos, or faggot jizz guzzlers. Other than that, I promise you a hilarious cacophony of hijinks and open conversation.
Forget about it Friday. That goes for listening to 560 WQAM.
One pill makes you drowsy, my friend, and it also makes you high. And the ones my housemaid gave me, they made me itchy all the time. Go ask Wilma. Yeah, she'll keep you well supplied. Downing them goofballs and hillbilly heroin bring me to a higher astral plane. I can have a groove drug and not get busted, thanks to my friends in a higher moral place. So go ask Wilma. She'll get you some horse and a handful of goofballs. I'm back, my supplicants, and ready to build those ovens to burn Jews and other dissenters' friends. Let's extract the gold out of their teeth to donate the proceeds to the RNC as a show of blind support for our glorious leader. And go ask Wilma. She'll get you through your show by putting logic out of proportion to justify your seething hate out my ass. I'm talking backwards, my fiddlehead friends.
Oh, down those little nipples.
Yep, you guys, please go. Yeah. Remember what Rush Limbaugh said. All drug abusers should be dead. That's the person prescribed it.
Amoco, BP, Bechtel, Vanel, and Shell, Halliburton, Unical, Chevron, and GE.
Oh!
Northrop, Enron, MCI, WorldCom, Baker, and Botts, KLR, and Care McGee. Kellogg, Brown, and Root, Carlisle, and the Rendon Group, Murdoch's, Fox News, and Reuters, Sung Young Moo.
Oh!
Choice Point Democracy by Database Technologies, Chuck Hagel's Diebold, blocking out your vote.
George Bush is a liar. Exploiting 9/11 for a global empire. George Bush is a liar. Impeach the unelected White House occupier.
Dick Cheney, Wolfowitz, Richard Pearl, another Dick, Andrew Carr, Carl Robin, Mark Rackitko. Neil Bush, Jeb Bush, George P. and Daddy Bush, Preston and Columba, Noel, not to mention Marvin. Traitor Bob Novak stabs CIA in the back. Rumsfeld says all is well, another soldier dies. Outspoken Democrat, in the mail they get anthrax. Carnahan, Wellstone, dead before their time.
George Bush is a liar, like all his corporate neocons with Nazi hard-ons. George Bush is a liar,
yes.
And the sinister media has you believing him. George Bush is a liar, the song is something that'll never get on your channel. George Bush is a liar, a traitor and an idiot and criminal piece of shit. George Bush is a liar,
liar, liar, liar, liar, liar, liar, liar, liar.
This year, ring in the holiday season with a voice that rings as clear as a jingle bell. It's a Macy Gray Christmas. Award-winning vocalist Macy Gray sings in a style that's beyond compare and a language that's beyond comprehension.
Will you marry me? Will you marry me? Will you marry me? Will you marry me?
On a Macy Gray Christmas, Macy sings all her Yuletide favorites like Hi There, Ain't Ya Hey, Right Here, How Here, and this indecipherable classic. A Macy Gray Christmas.
A Macy Gray Christmas is available at your local game action.
Sick Michael Jackson is backing up traffic. Cops looking for anything pornographic. Pictures and videos packed in boxes. They even took the big wig from the Wiz. Neverland Ranch smells like monkeys and llamas. Little boys wearing those trapdoor pajamas. Michael would secretly watch when they pee, then haul them up to that damn thinking tree. Teddy bears wearing tricolored vibrators. Underworld panties packed in the dumb waiters. Licorice gumdrops and Superman rings. Those are a few of his sick, freaky things. Michael Jacko, he's a wacko, he's going to jail. Will this wrong be righted? Will he be indicted? Put his Ferris wheel on sale.
My and local, this is Sports Radio 560, QAM.
Yes, dudes.
Was a blue Elvis met his doom. Chatter so blue there in the bathroom. Decorations of black on his casket I see. And burden, you weren't feeling quite right. Then your face turned all white. Oh, then you turned blue, 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 Elvis. Goodbye to you, Elvis, forever. Every night I'm at home and I'm watching TV. I have to sit through all his dumb movies and listen to Elvis whenever starts to croon. It's now or never. But as I watch his flicks and I look at all those chicks, I wish I knew if they blew, 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 blew Elvis. Oh, which one's blue Elvis?
Debbie?
Yeah, hi, Debbie. I'm interested in getting some operations done.
Okay.
And some body contouring and some liposuction.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering if you get some tummy tuck and lip augmentation, cosmetic breast surgery, facelift, all of these things.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering...
What would you like to start with?
Well, I need to get everything done. Probably the first thing I'd like to have removed is my thing.
Okay, we don't do that.
No. Could you do breast implants, though?
It can be done, but I don't know that it would do it right away.
It puts the lotion in the basket.
Mm-hmm.
How much?
$5,000.
Excellent. I'd like to have my skin resurfaced, too.
Mm-hmm.
Laser surgery.
Mm-hmm.
Have the lambs stopped crying yet, Mommy?
Excuse me?
Don't hurt Mommy's little baby. It puts the lotion in the basket. I'd like to get the liposuction that I saw on TV.
Okay.
Can you make me look more like a woman?
Well, we'll have to see you first, and then upon looking at you, we can tell you that when we see you.
Should I wear my skin suit made of body parts, Mommy?
If you'd like to.
It puts the lotion in the basket.
Would you like to make an appointment?
Yes.
Okay. There is a $100 consultation fee.
That's fine.
Okay. Okay.
My name is Buffalo Bill.
Okay, let me get a little
Mommy.
Information from you, okay? Just Mommy. One moment.
It puts the lotion in the basket.
I understand.
It puts the lotion in the basket.
Do you want to come in for a consultation?
Puts the lotion in the basket.
Okay. Would you like to make an appointment, or do you want to call me back?
It puts the lotion in the basket.
I understand.
I've got my skin suit nipple necklace.
Bill.
It puts the lotion in the basket.
I understand that. Would you like to
It puts the lotion in the basket.
Would you like to make an appointment?
It puts the lotion in the basket.
Okay, I will talk to you another time, okay?
It puts the lotion in the basket. Hello?
The mad dog is out of control, and you'll find out why when you hear the latest release from Blockbuster Entertainment. Jim Mandich sings duets.
Well, all right!
The Mad Dog, Jim Mandich, sing classic rock.
All right! 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 All right!
Mandich does blind faith. Said he felt a little bit foolish.
Kind of like a eunuch in a whorehouse.
But now, he says...
I like it. I like it.
The Mad Dog just can't piss enough of that cottage cheese butt.
If he wants me to sing God Bless America and pasties in a G-string up here, I'll do it.
You got soul, and everybody knows that it's
all right.
Whoa, it's all right.
Listen to the Mad Dog sing himself happy.
All right, all right. All right,
Jim Mandich sings duets, available now at all Blockbuster stores.
Bye, bye, bye.
The Neil Rogers Show on 560 WQAM, Miami, Fort Lauderdale.
I'm a fat Jew.
Absolutely.